Hello, everyone. It is Friday, May 5th. Happy Cinco de Mayo. I am Kelly O'Neill, and I am the director of the Imperiia Project. Hi, everyone. Just hanging on for a second here. So, yes, I'm Kelly O'Neill. I'm the director of the Imperiia Project at the Davis Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies. And I thought it would be fun to spend a couple of minutes on a spring Friday talking about things that bloom, green, lush spaces, gardens, fruit orchards, vineyards. And I want to talk particularly about vineyards and orchards that are found in a place called Crimea. I have to confess that there is a bit of a technical difficulty with my phone, which is not allowing me to share my slides with you. So I am going to point my phone at the images that I want to share, which simply means you won't be able to see me, which I think is probably okay. So let's see, hopefully this will work. I'm going to flip this around and adjust. Okay. And pardon the shakes, we will take care of this technical difficulty the next time we do this. And I will post the slides as well so that you can see them better. But you should be looking, among other things, at a map of the Black Sea region. And Crimea is located, it's a peninsula that's located in the northern part of the Black Sea. There is a red rectangle showing its location right now. Crimea is a place that has been mapped hundreds, if not thousands of times over the centuries, quite famously, and in some less spectacular ways. This is a very famous 19th century map of Crimea. And here's how it looks if you were to look at a contemporary, kind of a Google map image of Crimea. This is the peninsula, and you'll see some green splotches, which represent the forested areas of Crimea. We're going to zoom in just a little bit to the southern coast, to that forested area of Crimea. The reason for this is that what I want to talk about today is a combination of the salt water and the fresh water that plays such a key role in understanding the history of the Black Sea. Today, we're going to focus on some freshwater spaces, but it's important to keep in mind that that saltwater coast is surrounding the space and surrounding the story of Crimea. So here we are on the southern coast of the Crimean Peninsula, and the information that you're looking at right now is very contemporary, and you can do amazing things with modern map data. If I turn on a layer, we can see where the main waterways are in Crimea. If we zoom in just a little bit, there are some yellow splotches joining the green splotches. Those are orchards in Crimea, contemporary Crimea. And if I turn this on, you'll see some orange splotches that are also in place. Those are vineyard spaces. Again, this is contemporary Crimea. So you are looking at the land use patterns in the Crimean Peninsula as they were in August of 2022, according to OpenStreetMap data. It's an interesting thing to look at green space, forested space, the space of fruit trees and vineyards in Crimea, particularly now when Crimea is part of the highly contested kind of violence being perpetrated against Ukraine by the Russian Federation. Crimea was famously annexed by the Russian Federation in 2014. So it is now very much a contested space, and one we think of as being part of a geopolitical contest, not necessarily a garden space. But let's indulge that idea of Crimea as a garden space just for a few minutes on a Friday. All right, let's get a little bit closer. If we look at this map now, and again, if you're just joining us, apologies for the shaky. You have some red rectangles on the map, and those represent the locations of vineyard spaces, not in 2023, but in 1793. Let me zoom in a little bit and give you a sense of where the vineyards and the gardens were. They're represented by those dark red splotches in the late 18th century. So you're looking at a combination of contemporary and historical data. You'll see some splotches that are red now, and you'll also see some splotches that are blue. When the splotches turn color, that's because they're telling you who owned the gardens and orchards of Crimea in the 18th century. The splotches that are red are those that are owned by Crimean Tatars. And the splotches that are blue were owned by Christians, mainly Greeks, but also some Armenians who inhabited the Russian Empire in the late 18th century. These are very kind of rough cuts of the geography of gardens and orchards in the 18th century, but they give you a general sense of the space of kind of fruit and grape growing in Crimea. And you might want to ask yourself how it is that I know where the gardens were located in 1793. I mean, it's kind of a rare piece of information. One of the interesting things about orchards and vineyards is that the imperial government was pretty nearly obsessed with them. And when an imperial government gets obsessed with something that they think is important and possibly lucrative, they generate records. They generate records that end up in archives. So what you're looking at here is there are a couple of pages of the fruit and vineyard register that was compiled by imperial officials in 1793. Essentially, this means that the government sent officials out to walk the entire peninsula and count the pear trees, the cherry trees, the apple trees, and all of the grapevines they could possibly find, record their locations, and record who owned them. Kind of a tall order. I'm awfully grateful to them. Because they did this laborious work, they performed this task, we get a quick snapshot view of orchard and vineyard space in a newly annexed territory. Crimea had been annexed by Russia once before 2014. It happened in the year 1783. So this is just a few years after Russia took over Crimea that they produced this fruit and grape registry. It allows us to know where the apple trees were, at least where Russian officials thought the apple trees were, the ones that they bothered to count. And we can compare that with the distribution of cherry trees or pear trees, depending on your fruit of choice. We can go to plum trees, if you like, and see the relative distribution of plum trees and just imagine all of the luscious fruit being produced, particularly in the summer, in these areas of plum tree density. You'll see that there's some change across space in terms of the patterns. And one of the fun things we can do is look at the varietal distribution. The colors in those pie tree charts represent the different kinds of trees that grew in each of the areas. And you'll see that as you move through space, there are changes over time. There's a predominance of certain kinds of trees in certain areas. So there is an interesting geographical change. We can also compile the data and say, all right, I'm not so much interested in the peculiarities of plum trees, but I want to know, in general, where were most of the fruit trees in 1793? I'm sure that's a question that you've asked yourself millions of times, and I'm here to answer it. You can look across the distribution of all of these garden spaces in late 18th century Crimea and see that fruit tree distribution was relatively even across the spaces that we can locate. If we look at the grapevines, we see a slightly different story. We see that grapevine distribution does not look at all like fruit tree distribution. There are clear pockets of density in that kind of eastern area up here. Closer to Sudak and Feodosia, we see lots and lots of grapevines, whereas down further south along the coast, there's less grapevine activity. Now, we can look at grapevines and think about who owned the spaces and whether or not that helps us understand what was being produced, for what purpose, and according to what kind of cultural practice. Again, if we look at this map, we can see areas of red represent garden spaces that were owned by Crimean Tatars. And the larger the rectangle that you're looking at, the larger the amount of grapevines. So we can see in this kind of northeastern sector that there's a correlation between those two things. If we look down here a little bit further south along the coast, we see that there are indeed Christians owning vineyard spaces as well, which is something that we would expect to see in Crimea. And of course, that can lead to all kinds of questions about, well, were the Greeks who lived down here doing something different with their grapes than the Tatars, who were supposedly growing so many more grapes up here? Were the Tatars also making wine? And if they were they drinking the wine themselves? They were Muslims after all, right? So were they drinking wine? Were they making wine? Were they selling wine to others? Or what else were they making with their fruit, right? There are all kinds of interesting questions to ask, and we have answers to lots of them. If there's anything in particular you want to hear more about, you should put it in the chat and I'll answer it. Now, let's zoom in a little bit closer on the question of grapevines, where grapes were grown in the past and where grapes are grown now. Again, so those orange splotches that just reappeared are showing you the vineyard distribution in the present, and we're comparing it with the past. Now, if we kind of, I'm just gonna move right ahead, and I wanna actually show you one little thing, and that is that there's so much vineyard activity here, right? And very little activity here, despite the fact that in the present day, there's lots of vineyards. So that leads to a question, were there no vineyards here in the past? What's going on, right? When we zoom in on this area here in the east, we see that right now, look at all those splotches. I mean, it's a horrible looking image on your screen, I bet, but there are lots of vineyards and lots of orchards. And if we zoom in on this area in particular, we can see the forests, we can see the orchards, and we can see actually that in the past, if we bring our historical data back in, there were vineyards and orchards here. They just don't seem to be producing as many grapes. Is that what's going on? It isn't actually what's going on. What we actually see, one of the nice things about mapping data is it exposes the inconsistencies often, the gaps, the blanks in your data. And one of the blanks that I found in my data when I put this information on the map was the fact that in some areas of Crimea, the officials were really diligent. They did, in fact, go out and count all the trees and count all the grapevines. They did their job and they did it well. But in other parts of Crimea, they seem to have slacked off a little bit. And this is one of those parts of Crimea where we know there were vineyards and we know there were orchards, but no one bothered to count anything, which is awfully frustrating. Does that mean that there's nothing we can say about these less documented vineyards? No, it doesn't actually, happily, because there are other maps and other sources that we can turn to understand something about what was going on in these particular vineyard spaces of Crimea. You are looking now at a map that was made in 1816, so a decade or two after the great counting of fruit trees and grapevines. It's still pretty early on in terms of the age of imperial rule in Crimea. And this is a very famous topographical survey map that was made by a Lieutenant Colonel Simeon Mukhin. It would later go on to be kind of stolen by all kinds of other governments and translated and used during the Crimean War. But this early edition shows us that same location that we saw on the previous map. It's called Verkhosadnye now, but in the past it was called Duvankoy. And it shows up, and if you get up close and personal to the map, you'll see there are lots of little teeny tiny squiggly lines running along that river line in the middle. And those squiggly lines represent vineyards. Duvankoy was located right on the Belbek River. This is a yet another map of Duvankoy. And I know it might make your head spin, but we're gonna go back in time to the 1790s for this map. This is a plan of the estate, essentially, the dacha of Duvankoy. It was compiled in 1795, and it is a spectacularly beautiful map. It is about the size of a kitchen table. It's been folded and creased, and it hasn't been preserved before it got to the archives. It was used quite a bit, so the preservation isn't great, but it tells us all kinds of information about the village of Duvankoy, which we see located right in the center of the map. Let's get up close and personal again with the village of Duvankoy. So here it is. You can see that it has a beautiful, all of the place names in this map are all written in Russian. This is a map that was produced by Russian officials of space that had for centuries been Crimean Tatar, Greek, Armenian, Turkish, there were Italians, pretty much everyone but Russians prior to the time that this map was made. It's essentially a map that is meant to help the Russian Empire understand its newly acquired territory. And as you can see from looking at the map, you get those dark green spaces and they're kind of rough approximations of buildings, the inhabitants, the places where people actually lived. You can see some strange kind of brownish lines that represent ravines and bits of elevation change. And you can see just below the area of residences, there is a kind of dark blue squiggly line. And that is the line that represents the Belbek River. The Belbek River is it's not one of the most famous rivers in the world. This is no Volga. This is no Danube. It is a pretty minor 50 kilometer long river. It's really interesting though, because it flows out of the high mountains that are in the southern part of Crimea. It flows northward. Just north of Sevastopol, and its mouth spills out on the western coast of the Crimean Peninsula into the Black Sea. The fresh water that flowed down from the Crimean Mountains was the water that essentially irrigated the land and made it ideal for producing fruit trees and grapevines. And you'll see, so here's the inhabited area. And then over here to the left, just a bit west, following the river line, you see that the land is used a little bit differently. Suddenly, we have these little cute trees, right? And more squiggly lines, and we can see that they are in enclosed areas. These are the parts of the map that show us the locations of 18th century gardens and vineyards. And you can see how the space was parceled and shaped and had different owners. One of the interesting things about the orchard and vineyard spaces of Crimea was that those became some of the most hotly contested properties in the entire peninsula. When Russian rulers began assigning properties to the officials that they sent down there to administer the territory, the idea was that they would give them the most valuable and most productive spaces. And the empire quickly learned that in Crimea, it wasn't necessarily the open steppe land that could be farmed for grain production that was the most lucrative space. The most lucrative spaces in Crimea were the orchards and the vineyards. And so within 10 years after annexation, you get this growing obsession with orchard and vineyard spaces. And with obsession comes mapping. The estate maps, like this one, were made for the express purpose not just of knowing where where the plum trees were or how many grapes were there. These maps were made to assert control over these spaces. You'll see in the upper portion of the map a very elaborate title that explains how much territory within this area was allocated for residents, where the cemeteries were, how much of the space was underwater, how much was cultivatable, how much of it was non-arable. It tells you how much space was allocated to vineyards and to orchards. And then you get these interesting text boxes in the bottoms. And this is one of the reasons, I think, why the map had to be so big. It is jam-packed with information. Those other text boxes that you can see kind of arrayed along the bottom of the map include information about all of the people who claimed ownership to this particular area of Duvankoy on the Belbek River in kind of southwestern Crimea. The people who owned not just the adjacent territories, but pieces of the territory you can see included Tatar peasants, members of the Muslim clergy, the ulema. It included one of the most important Russian naval officers to make his way to Crimea, and a host of others. All of them were present at the construction of this map. All of them were there. They were forced to sign their names and essentially express their confirmation of the boundary lines and the claims to property that were attested on this map. A map that would eventually be creased and folded and tucked away and used for several decades until finally, in this case, in the 1840s, when it was finally decided who would own and control this territory. One of the interesting things about orchards and vineyards is that it took a really, really long time for the empire to figure out not just how many grapevines were there, but really how they were going to establish ownership of the most lucrative spaces. They were green. They were abandoned, actually. One of the last thing I want to say about these maps is that they had been orchard and vineyard spaces for, if not generations, then for centuries prior to Russia's first annexation of Crimea. These are places that were inhabited by, as I said, Greeks, Armenians, and Tatars. They had been cultivated for a very long time until the moment of political change. The moment of annexation in 1783 was a moment that forced the local inhabitants of the peninsula to decide whether they would stay or whether they would go. For some of them, they weren't actually given the option. They were forced to migrate. There was a lot of forced migration that went on. But through the process of Russia's annexation, the vast majority of Crimean gardens and vineyards lost their owners. The Greeks and the Armenians left in the late 1770s, actually, and many of the Crimean Tatars who owned these lucrative spaces left in and around the year 1783. What we get then is a glimpse. You know, this map shows us the spaces 10 years after all of this had happened. They are images both of lucrative space, of green space, of productive space, but also of abandoned space. And an example of how political reorganization leads to the social reorganization and significant changes in the way a landscape is used and what its meaning to the local inhabitants can be. There are so many ways to read a garden. There are so many gardens to be read. There are so many trees to be counted. This is just one map, right? This is just one space. The Crimea is just one story. Almost everything I told you has been gleaned from one archival record, right? There's so much more to say about the meaning of some of the smallest, kind of most boutique or niche places in a very large empire that has expanded across this space, making multiple claims to it over time. So what's your garden story? Have you ever counted trees? Maybe you should. And if you do, please tell us about it. Next week, we're going to again return to the area of the Black Sea and explore, kind of move away from Crimea and move to the space of the sea itself to explore one of the most famous nautical charts ever produced of the Black Sea. It was created in the 1840s by an Italian, and his views of the Black Sea are views that you'll just never forget. So come back and we'll shift from freshwater to saltwater. Enjoy your weekend. Thanks for being here.